May we always value, may we always treasure your presence.
Worship. We're going to continue in our worship with through our tithes and our offerings. There's many ways to give. You can give online through our app. You can give online all kinds. You guys know the drill. Where's our little video that has all the ways that we can give? But just as I was worshiping, how many of you guys trust God? Everybody's hands need to be up, right? You know, finances are always an odd thing to talk about, but sometimes it's not necessarily just our finances, but we had a meeting on Tuesday about our building, about speaking life into this building. And it's the same in anything that we do. It's whether we're even over us, ourselves, speaking life into ourselves, but it's speak a better word, the song that we were singing just a moment ago is speaking a better word. God speaks a better word into everything that we do. And that's even in our finances. God speak a better word over my finances. Sometimes we feel like we come short, but God can come through and just stretch out our dollars. Or God can come, we're maybe short in another area in our life or a relationship or whatever it is. If we ask God to speak a better word over that moment, he will speak a better word over it. So as we give our tithes and offerings, you can give over the One Church app, online, you can mail a check to our Modesto campus. Make sure it's Manteca. We have a little black box, not when the plane goes down, you pick out the black box, but we have a black box back there that you can drop out your offering as well. So I will pray for our offering, and then we will go into reminders. So Heavenly Father, I just ask you, speak a better word over our finances, whether it's in our church or individually, Lord. We just ask you just to continue to use the money to grow our kingdom builders, grow in our lives. Just be with us, Lord, and just use the money that we are able to give to spread it out through just everywhere in our community, in our church, through the missionaries. And I pray that over Jesus' name. Amen. Our new sermon series is coming up. Heaven, is that what it's cracked up to be? And if you guys listen to Maverick City Music, there's an awesome song. I have a horrible memory. I can't remember lyrics, but if a song comes on, I'll remember it. But there's an awesome song by Maverick City Music that talks about what does heaven look like. It looks like me and you. So we have the sermon series, Heaven, coming up. We had the video with the kids camp. I think we need to do an adults camp so we can get to go swimming and stuff. But as far as reminders, August 14th, some of you guys should have received an email from me. We have Grow Night. It's in Turlock campus. So if you want to email me or come see me at the hub after, we can get a little carpool going on or caravan or what have you, and we can all drive out there. I know it's a little ways away. But Grow Night is a second step to our after the Connect lunch. So if you guys want to come, I encourage you guys to come worship. It's an all campus worship after, and it is amazing. It was amazing here today, but it's double amazing out there. So our Connect, our favorite time of the service, our Connect connection break, we've got the question, what was the most funny and foolish thing you've ever done? I encourage everybody to come ask Pastor Anthony what his most foolish thing has ever been done, but that's the question we're going to ask for our connection break.
All right, well, go ahead and take your seats, take your seats. How's everybody doing? Everybody doing okay? Yeah, good, awesome, awesome. Well, did you guys have any funny stories? Was there anything like funny slash foolish that anybody wants to share? Yeah, okay, what was it? Yeah, oh, Camille, come on, tell me something good. Yeah, go ahead, what was it? Oh my goodness, that's awesome. Yeah, that's hilarious. Yeah, accidentally shooting off pepper spray. That's definitely something really funny slash foolish. That's great, that's awesome. My story was when I was in high school. I didn't know much, you know, so like growing up, I was young. I was in high school. I was a high school boy, right? And I remember one time my aunt, I was staying with her in Santa Rosa, and she said, hey, I want you to put all of the clothes, move them from the washer to the dryer. So I took all the clothes, and I took them out of the wash, and I put them in the dryer. And I never pressed start because I did exactly what she told me to do. I put them from the washer to the dryer, and then they just sat there and never actually got started. So that's one of the funnier, foolish things. I've never lived that down in my family. So, but man, we're so glad that you guys are here. Thanks for showing up today. So today we're in the middle of a series called Proverbs. And can I just pause real quick? You guys, last week, you guys did so good at just encouraging me and talking back to me when I was preaching. And I just want you guys to say thank you so much. I know my wife, she's watching online right now. Our kids are at home. They got runny noses, and you know how it is today. So we wanted to keep them home and make sure that we kept this place safe and all that. And so they're watching online. So hi, Luke. Hi, Camille. I don't know which camera we're on right now, but I love you guys. Wish you guys were here. But last week, she really encouraged me. I always say that I always preach better when she's in the front row. And so you guys, I need you guys to hype me up this week. Can you guys do that? Can we do that? All right, I need you guys to preach back to me, all right? So we're in the middle of this series called Proverbs. And we're talking about living a life of wisdom. And wisdom is something that's hard to really grasp, right? It's hard to get a handle on. Like, what is wisdom? We kind of know when people don't have it, and we kind of know when people do have it, but it's really hard to define wisdom, isn't it? It's hard to really get a firm grasp on it, but here's what wisdom does. It answers the question, what leads to the best possible life? What decisions that I make can lead me toward the best possible life? That's really what wisdom is. And so today, I want to talk about wisdom from that perspective. What decisions help me get to the best possible life? Are we getting my mic worked out? You guys hear a little feedback out there? Yeah, it's cool? All right. So that's the question that wisdom answers. But it's really complicated, isn't it? Because wisdom, really what it is it's seeing the right decision. But then it's also making the right decision, isn't it? That leads to that leads to flourishing. So it's the ability to actually see what the right decision is and then also to make the right decision. And how many of you guys know that's really complicated, isn't it? I remember I was driving and I had this great revelation. This was like months ago. And I was struggling with my weight a little bit, just to be honest with you guys. Like, I was struggling with my eating and I could not stop eating poorly. And I remember I was driving in the front seat of my car and I'm thinking, man, I want to be around when my kids are older. I want to be that guy that lives to his 90s and is still ticking and is in good health. And like, I know that my dad, like, you know those forms that they give you at the doctor's office where they say, hey, check this box if your family has a history of this and this and this. My dad's sheet, like, he is all of that in one human being, okay? He's got like generational health issues and he's got all of them. He had a quintuple bypass, which I didn't even know was possible, right? So that's the health that I come from. In my world, that's what I come from. And so I know that that's an issue for me. And I thought to myself, man, I want to be around when I'm 90. I want to be here still ticking. And I had this great revelation. I don't know if you guys realize this, but the difference between those who eat healthy and those who don't eat healthy is literally just what people put in their mouth. I realized that. I had a revelation. I was like, oh my gosh, it's literally just what I put inside of this tiny little hole in my face. That's the difference between being fit and being healthy and being unhealthy, yet it's so difficult to do that. Why is that? Because it's bringing together all of these disciplines. Eating wisely is bringing together all of these disciplines and getting all of those things moving in the right direction so that we can flourish as human beings. And that's hard, right? Like, we have to have the understanding, the foresight to see, okay, I want to be here when I'm 90. And then we've got to have the understanding of how do I actually get there? Well, I eat at a calorie deficit, right, if I want to lose weight. I eat food that's low caloric density. That stuff is important. It's knowing what to eat. But then come decision time, it's the ability to actually say, okay, I'm going to eat healthy. It's putting together that willpower. So it's all of these different areas in your life coming together that will lead you toward greater flourishing. That's what wisdom is. And so today we're going to talk about wisdom. And today specifically, we're talking about four different types of fools that Proverbs talks about. Four different types of fools. So would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, today we just thank you. We thank you so much that you're here, that you're in the room. And God, today I pray that you would speak to your people, Lord. God, would you be here? Would you be with us? Would you help us? God, give us a revelation of your word today. God, help us to understand your word. And I pray that it would be powerful for us. God, that you would come in, that you would speak to us. God, and that your glory would be in this place. Lord Jesus, we love you so much. And we pray, Holy Spirit, be here. Teach us from your word today. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. Okay, so in our household, we have this thing called the ticket system. And it's kind of like growing up, you remember getting like money every, what do they call that? I don't know why I can't think of the word, right? An allowance, yeah. It's kind of like getting an allowance, the ticket system. Anytime my son does what he's supposed to, he gets a ticket. So if he cleans up his room, he gets a ticket. If he's nice to his sister, he gets a ticket. If he gets 20 tickets, he gets to watch a show. If he gets 30 tickets, he gets to take mom and dad out to dinner. If he gets 100 tickets, he gets his own toy. He gets to go to Target and pick out his own toy. Okay? So my son worked for months. Months and months and months. He worked hard. He behaved well. And he got to the point where he earned 100 tickets. And so I took him to Target. And I could see his little eyes overwhelmed as he's walking through the aisle. He's like, I can have anything that I want. And being a four-year-old, he goes through the aisle. And he walks down the aisle. And he grabs the first thing that he sees. He says, Dad, I want this. And I look down at it. And it's this tiny little toy. It's like $3 or $4. That's it. And I look at him. And I'm like, oh, buddy. You can get something a little bit more expensive than that. Like, that's really cheap. Why don't you put that back? He's like, no, I want this one. I'm like, that's just too cheap. I wanted him to want the right thing, right? So he took this toy and he put it back on the shelf. And then he grabs the largest toy that he could possibly find. And he comes, he's like, Dad, I want this. I'm like, ooh, I think we overcorrected here a little bit, okay? Because that's like $100, and that's a little bit too much. We're looking in like the $25 range, buddy. So finally, he picks out the right toy, and it's like right in the perfect, you know, margin. It's about $25, and he picks it out, and he gives it to me. I'm like, all right, buddy, you can have that one. He was so thrilled. And for me, I wanted him to want the right thing. Now, we see this scenario in the Bible. There's a man by the name of Solomon. And God comes up to Solomon and he says, Solomon, you can have anything that you want. Imagine that. Has anyone ever put you in a situation like that? Where they said, here, you can pick out whatever you want. You ever been in a situation like that? That would be awesome, right? I wish my parents would have done that for me growing up. So God says, Solomon, you can have anything that you want. Here's Solomon's response. He says, give me wisdom and knowledge that I may lead this people, for who is able to govern this great people of yours. That's what Solomon says. He says, God, I can have anything. But he doesn't ask for health. He doesn't ask for fame. He doesn't ask for wealth. What does he ask for? He asks for wisdom. Wisdom. What a selfless answer. I mean, imagine how amazing is that? He could have had anything that he wanted. He could have had fame, could have had money, could have had health. But he didn't. He asked for wisdom. And the reason that he asked for wisdom was because he would have to lead the people of God. And that's a difficult task. And Solomon knows at some point the people of Israel would ask him this question, what do we do? Solomon, you're the leader. This is complicated. What do we do? That's a scary question, isn't it? I mean, the reality is all of us are leaders in our lives, aren't we? Every single one of us. You know, you might lead an organization, you might lead a company, you might lead a team, you might lead a family. You might lead the most complicated organization on the planet. You might lead yourself. Right? And we're a little complicated. We need leadership. And when you're in a place of leadership, people are always asking that question, what do we do? Where do we go? And that's a scary question because we know that the answer to that question, what we decide determines our destiny in life. What we decide determines where we will go and where we will be in life. And so it's important that we have wisdom, that we long for the wisdom of God to make the right decisions, to steer our life, and to steer the people that we lead in the right direction. And it's easy for us who don't have wisdom to come to that place where we get what I call analysis paralysis. Anyone ever been there? Where you're like, I have to make a decision. And we used to play this board game. We'd have some friends that would come over to our house. We played this board game called Settlers of Catan. Anyone play Settlers of Catan? Yeah, it's a great strategy game. And so we'd all sit around this table, and there'd be like four of us. And the idea was that as everybody else is taking their turn, you're strategizing in your head so that when it came around to your moment to make a decision, that you could make it quick because you've had all this time. But if it came to you and you didn't know what decision to make and you were stuck, right, in this moment and you took a long time, we would all yell, analysis paralysis, right? We would all yell that at you because you didn't take your time to think through the strategy that you wanted to do. And so you're here and you're in this place where you're like, I don't know what decision to make. Now, this is kind of an anticlimactic thing to ask for, at least I think, you know, because I've grown up in this culture and I've grown up in this world, and this world loves the sensational. But here, Solomon doesn't ask for the sensational. He asks for wisdom, for wisdom. And honestly, I've read that 1,000 times, and almost every time I thought, wisdom? Really? That's what you're going to ask for? Of all the things you're going to ask for wisdom? The thing that old people have? That's what you want? Like, why don't you want passion? Why don't you want humor? Why don't you want charisma? Because honestly, in our culture, wisdom is forgotten. We don't really care about it all that much because wisdom's not the belle of the ball, is she? She's not the prettiest girl in the room. Nobody asked wisdom to prom. Everybody asked, you know, charisma and a sense of humor and beauty and health. Everybody wants those things, but nobody wants wisdom, right? But see, we need wisdom because we don't know how much we need wisdom until we come to the point where we go to a situation where we need to make a decision and we realize that we don't have her. Wisdom is underrated. And in our culture, wisdom is unattractive. But let me paint a different picture of wisdom for you. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 11 says this, "Wisdom is more precious than rubies. Nothing you could want is equal to it." Literally, nothing in your life that you could want is equal to wisdom. Being able to see the right decision and make the right decision that will lead to flourishing in your life. And let me prove to you that our culture is just longing for wisdom. I don't know if you realize this, but 1 in 5 Americans will see a psychic in their life. And during the pandemic, the psychic industry was up 140%. 140%. It is now a $2.5 billion industry. And one lady who led a psychic hotline, her call volume doubled after the pandemic. She said she was getting like 10 to 15 calls a day. Now she was getting 20 to 30. We long for wisdom because we live in a complicated society, don't we? We live in a complicated culture where it feels like the world is falling apart and we are longing for people to answer that question. What do we do? How do we live? Where do we go? We're dying for understanding, and we're longing for it so much that we'll pick up the phone and we'll call anybody who we think has some semblance of wisdom. We'll even call and consult the psychic. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7 says this, "Getting wisdom is the most important thing that you can do." Getting wisdom is the most important thing that you can do. Do you believe that in your life? So today we're going to look at 4 different types of fools, okay? And it's important to look at what Proverbs calls a fool, because in order to understand what wisdom is, we have to know what the opposite is, okay? So let's look at wisdom for a second, and then we're going to jump into the 4 types of fools. Now, wisdom in the book of Proverbs is presented as a paradox, okay? Now, let me read to you what this paradox looks like. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 20 says this, "Wisdom cries aloud in the streets. In the market, she raises her voice." Wisdom cries aloud in the streets. So here's the picture that we get of wisdom. That wisdom is a loud talker. That she's an extrovert. She's crying aloud. She really wants you to hear the lessons that she has to teach. And it says she cries out in the marketplace, which means she cries out in everyday experience. So every day we experience things and wisdom is trying to teach us her lessons. She's a loud talker. Anybody ever met a loud talker? I dated a loud talker once. This was before Laura, the dark ages, okay? Like before I met my wife. And I dated a girl and she, you know, Friday night she'd be like, "Hey, can we go to the movies?" I'd be like, "You know, let's maybe not go to the movies today. We're gonna keep it maybe at home, like hang out together, like in private, not in public." Because I knew that she would talk through the whole thing and bother people. She's a loud talker, and that's what wisdom is. But then check this out. Here's the other end of the paradox. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 4 says, "Search for them as you would for silver. Seek them like hidden treasures." So not only is wisdom an extrovert, and a loud talker, but wisdom's also an introvert, and she's quiet, and she wants you to search her out. And so there is a very real scenario in which wisdom is hidden in plain sight. For many of us, wisdom, it's out there in the open. It's a loud talker, but it's also something that you need to search for. And here's how I would illustrate that. Have you ever Have you ever met somebody who, like maybe it was a woman and she was dating somebody who didn't treat her very good? Everyone else could see it, but she couldn't see it herself. She was blind to it, but everyone else could see it. Or that 20-year-old that makes terrible decisions over and over and over and ruins relationships, and everyone else can see it except for that person. Wisdom is hiding in plain sight right in front of their eyes. Tim Keller, he says it like this. He says, fools fail to see these boundaries embedded in reality, physical, psychological, relational, and spiritual. They step outside of them and they wonder why they sink. And so here is who the fool is. The fool is the person who fails to see the boundaries that are embedded in reality, right? It's a 20-year-old who's, you know, taking college classes and they stay up all night playing video games and then they wonder why they can't get their homework done, right? Maybe it's because you're playing video games all day. Or it's the girl who is up for a new job in her office and she's wanting a promotion, yet she's a gossip and she wonders why she can't get that promotion that she wants. Well, maybe it's because you're gossiping and you're spreading a culture of gossip in your company. And so, see, that's what foolishness is. It's failing to see these boundaries that are embedded in everyday life. A fool in the book of Proverbs is someone who's so out of touch with reality that they make life miserable for themselves and for everyone else. They're out of touch with reality. They don't realize what their actions are leading them to. They don't see the relationship between their actions and their outcome. And that's what the fool is in the book of Proverbs. Thus, those who are wise are those who are so in touch with reality. They're so in touch with the boundaries of life that they are a blessing to themselves and to everyone else. And so the question I want to ask today is, what creates a person like that? What makes a person wise and what makes a person a fool? Well, Proverbs gives us four examples of fools, so we're going to look at those today. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 22. If you've got your Bibles open, flip open to it, or it'll be up on the screen. Here's what it says. It says, how long will you who are simple love your simple ways? And how long will mockers delight in mockery and fools hate knowledge? How long will the simple love their way? So that is the first type of fool, is the simple. So here's what the simple is. This is the simple person. It's one who is easily influenced or gullible. It's one who is easily influenced or gullible. And I'll say that this is probably the majority of people in my generation, and I would say below. I think that right now we are dealing with an epidemic of exactly what this is talking about. Because you think about it, there's literally heroes in our culture right now that we elevate and we call them influencers. They shape what we desire. They shape what we're into. They shape our mentality on everything, and we're influenced by them. In fact, one of the original influencers is a guy named Edward Bernays, and he lived decades ago. I want to say probably in the 40s or 50s, and he's who people call him the father of modern day public relations. And this guy was like the nephew of Sigmund Freud, okay? So like imagine a guy who like psychologically is really in touch with the nature of human beings. And he had a couple different clients that he worked with. And one of his clients was an organization called Lucky Strike. And Lucky Strike made cigarettes. And so one day Lucky Strike comes up to Edward Bernays and they say, hey, we have a problem. And here's what the problem was. They were doing very poorly with the female demographic. And so they come up to Edward Bernays and they say, hey, can you fix this for us? Can you figure out what's wrong? And so Edward Bernays, he goes through their whole company and he sits down and he has a meeting with them and he says, I know exactly what's wrong with Lucky Strike and why women aren't smoking more cigarettes. And they said, oh yeah, why don't you tell us? And he said, it's because your box is green. And green was a masculine color. And green was incredibly unfashionable to women at the time. And so they didn't want to touch a cigarette. And so his suggestion was, why don't you just change the color of your cigarette box? And here's what they said. They said, absolutely not. We've spent money on branding and on these boxes, and so we're going to keep them you have to figure out another way. And he says, okay, you won't change the color of your box. Here's what he says. He says, fine, we'll make green fashionable. So here's what he set out to do. He set out to, instead of just change the color of the box, he decided that he was going to change America. And so he threw something called the green ball. He never once mentioned Lucky Strike, but he threw something called the green ball. And he sent out invitations to all sorts of different people in culture, all the most famous Hollywood people. He invited them to this party called the Green Ball. And there was one requirement: you had to wear green. And so all these Hollywood people showed up, and they took all these pictures with all the magazines and media people. They took pictures in these green dresses, and they put them on the front of newspapers. And the message was, green is in. And all of a sudden, after that moment, more women started smoking cigarettes because this one man had the ability to shape culture. Now, what did he do? He played into people's desire to be accepted and to be in. He played on people's desire to be accepted in culturally and by people. And because he did that, he shaped culture. And what we have to understand is there are so many people out there right now who are trying to shape us. They're trying to form us. And what do? They suck us in with this desire to be accepted and this desire to be in. We desire it so much. So one of the wisest things that we can do is unhitch ourselves from a fear of man. One of the wisest things that we can do in our life is to unhitch ourselves from the desire to be in, to be popular, and to be accepted, and to hitch ourselves to what Proverbs calls the fear of the Lord. Proverbs says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And here's why. Because the person that owns your desires owns your decisions. The person that owns your desires owns your decisions. And the person that owns your decisions owns your destiny, where you will end up in your life. And so if God owns your desires, if your sole desire in life is to be accepted by him, to be loved by him, to be in with him, then guess what? He owns your decisions. And if he owns your decisions, he owns your destiny. He will give you wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. It's where wisdom starts, not the fear of man, not the opinions of others. That's the simple. Second one is the mocker. Okay, and the mocker is somebody who's a cynic, someone who's right about everything. Right? They're the person that's always right about everything. And here's what the Bible says about the mocker. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 24 says this: mockers are proud and haughty. They act with boundless arrogance. So what's the problem of the mocker? It's pride. It's arrogance. It's somebody who thinks that they know it all. Right? And here's what this shows us. The fact that the mocker makes the list, it proves that it's not mental capacity that makes somebody wise or foolish, but oftentimes it's our attitude. What makes people wise or foolish, it's not their mental capacity, because let's be honest, some cynics, at least people that I've met in my life, sometimes the cynics in the room are some of the smartest people you've ever met. The problem is, they're also the smartest people that they've ever met, right? They just are so full of themselves. They think that they know it all. And here's the reality. Here's the reality. A lot of times, and this is coming from a young person, I am a young person, and we'll get to that in a second. But a lot of times it's the younger generation, right? It's those young people who think, oh man, I know it all. I've got it all figured out. And see, what we don't realize is we're shaped like this from the very beginning. If you've seen any sort of Disney movie lately, what you'll realize is that the narrative is always this. It's always the kid knows best, the parent knows least. And it always works itself out to the point where the parent comes around to the children's opinion, right? Okay, let's take Moana, for instance. Moana, she wants to leave the island. She said, Mom, Dad, I'm made for the sea. And they say, no, you need to be here. You're a princess. You need to lead this village. And she says, no, I'm made for the sea. So what does she do? She goes out to sea. What happens in the end? The parents have a change of heart. What happens in Luca? You guys remember that movie, Luca? It's a great one if you haven't seen it. It's fantastic. It's one of my favorite. And Luca is all about this kid who's a sea monster, and he lives undersea, and his parents don't go up on dry land, even though they have the ability to, because it's a scary and it's a dangerous place. So what does Luca do? He leaves the water, he goes up on dry land, and his parents have like this freak out moment, but eventually they come around to realizing, oh, it's not that dangerous. It's actually really safe. Now, what does this show us? It shows us that our culture wants to paint wisdom as being something for young people and foolishness as something for the older generation, where the Bible paints the opposite picture. Wisdom is not something that's necessarily for the young, although young people can get a good amount of wisdom. But here's where wisdom lies. It lies in the hands of people who are older. And here's what I mean. There was a study that was done with the Tallahassee SWAT team. They did this big study with this police department. All these scientists came out. And here's what they wanted to find out. They wanted to find out how people who were fresh out of the police academy performed in comparison to officers who had been around for a while. And so they did this big study, and here's how this big study worked. They took them out to a school, and they monitored how they operated in different scenarios. So one of the scenarios was there was a school, and they had steps that were leading up to the front door. And so they sent a bunch of people up the steps, and the first set of officers that they put out were the officers from the academy. Now, as the people walked up these steps, there was one man who was in a coat, and he had a big bulge inside of his coat that was supposed to be a bomb. And every single time, the people who were fresh out of the academy missed the guy with the bomb. And then they put in the officers who were the ones that were seasoned. And so these officers are out there, and almost every single time, the seasoned officers who have been around the block a few times, every single time they caught the guy who had the bulge in his coat, and they arrested him. Okay? Now, when they sat these police officers down and they asked them, hey, how did you know that that person was the person with the bomb? How did you know? They said they just had this gut feeling. They said, oh, it's intuition. I just kind of sensed that this was the guy. But as they drilled down deeper, what they found out was it was actually a function of their memory. Check this out. It says this, and this is Josh Ford. He writes about this in his book, Moonwalking with Einstein. It says this. The experienced SWAT officer doesn't just see a man walking up the front steps of the school. He sees a nervous twitch in the man's arm that calls up associations with dozens of other nervous twitches he's seen in his years of policing. He sees the suspect in the context of every other suspicious person he's ever come across. He perceives the current encounter in the context of past encounters like this. Now, this is something that shocked the researchers, because as they're looking at this, they're thinking, these kids, they come out of the academy, of course they're going to be great, right? They just were studied, they read all these books, they trained, but it was the officers that had experience that were able to see the person with the bomb. And what was it? It manifested itself in this feeling of intuition. But really what it was they've been in that scenario several times, over and over and over. They knew what to look for, and so they saw the twitch in the man's arm. And it was, I mean, they were working through, in their mind, they were working through this scenario so quickly that they thought it was their intuition, when really what it was they had experience in life. And so, really, what we have to remember is that the older generation, they have this wisdom that a lot of people in my generation don't have. You know, I knew coming into this when we planted this church, I'm a young guy. Pastor Arabella, she told you my age a couple weeks ago. She told you I was 12. She's wrong. I'm 12 and a half. So, you know, when you're this young, you count half years. I'm a young leader. And I knew that coming into this. And that was one of the things that I really struggled with. Like, when we started this whole process, I mean, we were so young. And now we're 3 years into this process of planting the church. We've 1 year with the actual church plant. But man, I feel like I've grown so much. But going into this, we knew we're young leaders. We're going to make some mistakes. And there's going to be some mistakes that I make as a young leader that leaders who are older than me wouldn't make, because they have the reps. They've been doing this longer than I am. And so I wanted to make sure I surrounded myself with older leaders. And so we actually tried to bring a guy who was in his 60s from our old church, and he's been a mentor of mine since I was in seventh grade. We tried to bring him with us, and because we wanted to surround ourselves with older leaders who had been there. We were looking for somebody really old, and so the Lord blessed us with Pastor Arabella. I'm just kidding. We joke. But we knew we wanted to surround ourselves with people who had wisdom. And here's the reality. Wisdom comes through experience. Experience comes through time. and time comes from age. Now, here's the reality of things. Wisdom doesn't just come with experience, does it? We all know that because we've met the older person who has experienced everything and learned nothing. We've all been there and we've seen that type of person. However, having gone through experiences in life gives you a leg up. And so I think it's important for me, just as somebody who's part of a younger generation, it's important for me to carry a spirit of I don't have it all figured out yet. Right? Because oftentimes we can walk through life saying, man, I've got it figured out. I know exactly what to do, but I don't. And so if I carry that spirit around in me of like, nah, I don't have it all figured out yet, it's going to put me in a place of wisdom rather than being the mocker. There's a couple scientists I want to make you aware of. There's two guys named Dunning and Kruger, and these are psychologists, and they're incredibly famous because of some of the research that they've done on confidence. And so who Dunning-Kruger are is they studied people, and what they found is this. They found that the most incompetent people are often the most overconfident. It's actually called the Dunning-Kruger effect, that the less that you know about something, the more you're actually overconfident about it. And then the vice versa is true as well. That the more that you know about a subject, the more underconfident that you feel, because you realize as you jump into things that the world is a lot more complicated than you thought that it was when you first started in a specific subject or a specific topic, right? The most incompetent are oftentimes the most overconfident, and that scares me because I wonder to myself, what stuff am I overconfident about? Because I'm incompetent, right? So it's important for us to carry around the attitude of, I don't have it all figured out yet. Okay, the third person is the troublemaker. And this is the person that's in constant conflict. We've encountered this person several times throughout our life. Everybody has, right? Somebody who's constantly starting conflict. It's the troublemaker. And these are the people who like to burn bridges rather than build bridges. Proverbs chapter 6 verse 12 says this: a troublemaker and a villain who goes about with a corrupt mouth, who winks with maliciously with his eyes, signals with his feet and motions with his fingers, who plots evil with deceit in his heart, he always stirs up conflict. Therefore, disaster will overtake him in an instant. He will suddenly be destroyed without remedy. So this is what the troublemaker does. They go around everywhere and they stir up conflict. And because they do that, therefore, disaster will overtake them. And oftentimes in life, we miss that one word, that therefore. There are therefores that are built into the world. If we're going around and we're stirring up conflict, we're going to be swept up in the wake of the conflict that we're stirring up. And that's one of those boundaries in life that people don't see. And really, this is the essence of wisdom and foolishness in the book of Proverbs. It's this, that we will eat the fruit of what we sow in life. If we sow trouble, we will reap trouble. If we sow troublemaking, we're going to get caught up in the wake of that. And the wise person always remembers that there is a therefore built into everything that we do in life. We will reap what we sow. Okay, and the fourth one is the sluggard. And this is the lazy person. This is somebody who's got no motivation in life. It's the person that constantly has to be motivated. Let me read to you Proverbs chapter 6, verses 6 through 11. It says, go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise. It has no commander, no overseer or ruler. Yet it stores its provisions in the summer and gathers its food at harvest. How long will you lie there, you sluggard? When will you get up from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of hands to rest, and poverty will come on you like a thief, and scarcity like an armed man. And so here's what God is speaking to the sluggard, to the person that's lazy. He says, look at the ant. There's nobody motivating him. Nobody's cracking the whip behind him. He is self-motivated. But we all know those people in life who need to be motivated. But what I see in this passage is this. Like when you read this, you see that the sluggard is saying things like a little sleep, a little bit of rest. Well, then what happens? Poverty will come like a thief. Again, you've got somebody who's eating the fruit of the decisions that they've sown in their life. They've made a lot of small consequences, and all of those small consequences turn into big consequences. And really, this is a huge theme in the book of Proverbs, that we as human beings, we do a very poor job of seeing the path that our actions are taking us down. And this is a warning. It's a warning to all of us. It's a warning that the problems that we face in our lives are often our own doing, and often a result of the decisions that we make. So I'm going to invite the worship team up front today. And if you would, stand to your feet. Go ahead and stand to your feet. We're going to bow our heads and close our eyes. We're going to take a quick moment to respond. And I want you to think about these four. Here's the reality. Every single one of us is unwise. We all have tendencies toward a lack of wisdom. Every single one of us. It's called the sin nature. Sin nature is an inability to serve God in the way that God desires us to serve him. So every single one of us, we have tendencies toward foolishness. So I want you to think, just for a quick second, like if that had to be you, you in your worst moment, which one are you? Are you the simple that's easily influenced? You have a tendency to be the mocker. Are you the person that says, oh man, I've got it all figured out, and you roll your eyes at everything in life? Are you the troublemaker, stirs up conflict where you go? Are you the sluggard that needs to be motivated? Every single one of us has a tendency toward foolishness. And the question I want to ask you today is, which one is your particular brand? What's your brand of foolishness? I said it before, I think for me, it's the simple. Sometimes I get easily influenced because I care about what people think about me. And my job is to unhitch myself from the opinions of other people and to hitch myself to the fear of the Lord. And so today, as you're thinking of what particular brand of foolishness that you struggle with is, here's what I want you to do. During this last and final song, I want you to think about why you tend that direction. Pull on that thread a little bit. Think to yourself, why is it that I tend toward being a sluggard, being a troublemaker? If you're the simple, maybe it's because you care too much about what people think. Or if you're the mocker, maybe it's because you don't feel valuable in life, and so you have low self-worth, and so you act like you know it all. Maybe you're the troublemaker, and the reason that you stir up conflict is because you feel this deep need to feel heard by people. Maybe you're the sluggard, and it's because you have a deep fatigue inside of you because you've lived depressed, and you need the Lord to uplift you. What is it that you struggle with, and why do you struggle with that particular brand of foolishness? And as we're singing this last song, I want you to take a moment to give that over to the Lord. Surrender it to God and say, God, I repent of my foolish ways. And God, I want wisdom. Today, I want to know the right decision to make. And I want to have the power to make that right decision so that I can lead my life in the ways that you have called me to lead my life. So that I can end up in a place of flourishing rather than a place of foolishness. So I want to pray for you today, and I want to pray that the Holy Spirit today inspires you. So Lord, today I pray for your people. God, I pray today that the Holy Spirit would inspire us. God, that you would give us wisdom and understanding. And God, we know that your Holy Spirit is the teacher. He's the teacher of wisdom. He's the one that gives us wisdom. And so Holy Spirit, I pray today, open up our eyes, open up our ears. Help us hear your voice. And I pray if there's a particular brand of foolishness that we're struggling with, God, that you would lead us to that. And God, that you would give us the power to cure it. Because Lord, we need you in our life, or else we will find ourselves in ruin. Holy Spirit, come. Give us wisdom. Give us life. Give us insight today. Because God, we want to know you. And we want to know how to live the best possible life. So Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time. Today, teach us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship.
Cross you bore so I could live. and the freedom you died for. Now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name. Praise. is your name.
Amen. Well, I want to pray for you, just kind of a benediction prayer as you guys go. I want to pray for your week. So would you just bow your heads with me? We're going to pray one more time. Lord Jesus, I pray for my friends in this room. God, I thank you that this is a room full of people who are filled with the Holy Spirit. And God, this is a room full of people today, God, that you want to bless with wisdom. God, you want to give them the insight that our culture is longing for, so that in a culture where nobody knows what to do, they don't know what decisions to make, God, you want to give them the insight to know which decisions are the right decisions so that our culture can be drawn to us, Lord. God, make us a people of godly wisdom. Lord Jesus, today we love you. God, we thank you for this word, for this reminder that we need to be a people who lean into the wisdom of God, lean into the revelation that you're giving us every single day to search for wisdom, because it is the most important thing that we can get in our life. Today, Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time together in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, God bless you guys. Thank you guys so much for coming this week. If you guys are new, make sure you grab your Connect card, fill it out, bring it back to Sonia at the Hub. And we got Grow Night coming up in a couple weeks, so make sure you guys get signed up for that. And Heaven starts next week. God bless you guys. Have a great week.